You know, Peter Lynch has always said, buy a business that's so good that any idiot can run it, because sooner or later one will. And, well, all I know is if I buy the right kind of business at the right price with the right people, I'll do well over time.
You're about to meet one of the most successful investors in the world, Warren Buffett. He gained that distinction by shrewdly investing his own and other people's money. Starting in the 1950s and 1960s, he ran an investment partnership that earned a remarkable annual average return of nearly 30% per year for 13 years. In 1965, he paid $12 a share for a company named Berkshire Hathaway. In 1995, Berkshire Hathaway, which is now an investment holding company, was trading on the New York Stock Exchange for over $25,000 per share. Based in Omaha, Nebraska, Berkshire Hathaway owns shares in such large companies as Coca-Cola, Gillette, and Capital Cities ABC, as well as 100% of such smaller companies as See's Candies, H.H. Brown Shoes, and a furniture store in Omaha, Nebraska, named the Nebraska Furniture Mart. In 1994, Forbes magazine listed Warren Buffett as the second richest man in America, but he's famous for far more than just his wealth. His common sense approach to business decision-making is widely admired, both for its wit and its wisdom. In what follows, you'll hear about how he chooses companies to buy, about his views on predicting the stock market, and about some of his favorite people, including Rose Blumkin, the 101-year-old founder of the Nebraska Furniture Mart. The format's the one he enjoys the most, a dialogue with a group of students who are invited to throw at him any questions they like. He begins with a story about near disaster in the financial world. It happened when the top management of the huge Wall Street securities firm of Salomon Brothers, in which Berkshire Hathaway held a stake, was forced to resign after a treasury bond trading scandal. Mr. Buffett stepped in as chairman, and his first challenge was to find the right man to run the highly leveraged company, and fast.
I really had a lesson on unemployment a few years ago. When on August 14th of 1991, I got a phone call at 6:45 in the morning. It was the top management of Salomon, and they told me at 6:45, essentially, that that the head of the Fed of New York, who was the most powerful man in finance, basically, told them that the top management was unacceptable, and that therefore they were going to offer their resignations, and there was no one there to run the place. And that was a matter of some concern, because at the time, Salomon had balance sheet totals of $150 billion, of which about $4 billion was equity, and the other $146 billion was owed to someone else. And that was the largest amount owed by any American corporation, except for Citicorp at that time. It's larger than the liabilities of the Prudential Insurance Company, larger than the liabilities of the Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, American Express, whatever. And there was one problem about this $146 billion, that a very high percentage of it came due within a few weeks. And so that was the situation, and I went back to New York that day, on that Friday, and I met that evening, and this is where it may start getting relevant to this group. One of the problems I was going to have the following week was I needed somebody to run the place. There were 8,000 people and this $150 billion of balance sheet assets and liabilities, and a complex business, and essentially somebody had to be making decisions minute by minute about the operations, because I was going to have to be dealing with regulators and legislators and people of that sort. So I met 12 people, roughly 12, that evening, a dozen or so, and I probably knew four or five of them by sight. And there were probably six or seven that I didn't know, although I probably knew their names. So as I interviewed these people, making what for me was the most important hire by far that I'll ever have to make, it may be of interest to you, because it may not be quite as dramatic a time when you get hired, but it may be some of the same things going through the person that's looking at you, the mind of the person that's looking at you. The good news is I did not ask them their grades in business school. The bad news, of course, is I didn't ask them whether they'd been to business school at all. I never looked at a resume. It wouldn't have made any difference. I knew that all 12 had the IQ to handle the job. No one had gotten to that position in the firm without being smart enough to know all the instruments and know how markets work and all of that sort of thing. So it wasn't a question of, IQ at all. It's just sort of hearing how their machinery works, and you can tell the people that are very full of themselves. I mean, that's very easy to do. You find a few of those in investment banking, believe it or not. You can probably detect perhaps the ones that aren't going to have the courage in a situation like that. But I wanted the qualities, you know, the same thing Ben Franklin wrote about a couple hundred years ago. The people who don't, who are always willing to give the other person more credit than themselves, and who don't cut corners, and who deliver all their promise and a little extra. And essentially, I was very lucky because I found that individual, a fellow named Derek Maughan, and he, the next day, the board met, and we had a lot of complications that day, and we had a group of about 200 reporters, probably about this size, in an auditorium, would come in on Sunday to cover this story, I walked out, they assembled at about 2:30, I walked out of the director's meeting about a quarter of three, it was late because of other problems, and there these 12 were, and I just walked up to this, to Derek, and I tapped him on the chest, and I said, "You're it, pal," and we went right down to the auditorium, and 200 or so reporters fired questions at him for 3 hours while he sat up at the podium with about 2 minutes notice that he was going to be running the firm. A month later, Derek Maughan never had asked me what he was getting paid. The question of his salary had never come up. Forget about stock options or anything like that. Never came up. He just walked right up and never said a word about it, and took on the job. Worked 18-hour days for months and months and months. Showed uncanny judgment about what to bring up to me and what not to bring up to me, and all sorts of things like that. And I often use this illustration with a class, is that I say to them, if you were looked under your seat today, and one of you had this lucky ticket, and the one who had that ticket got to pick one of their classmates, you've been together for a couple of years or whatever, and you got to pick one of your classmates, and you could pick anyone you wanted to, you had an hour to make the decision, and you would get 10% of the earnings of that individual for the rest of their life, and you don't pick the guy with the richest father in the class, but we'll assume you pick everybody starting from scratch. But what would you think about in that hour in terms of who you picked? Would you think about who had the highest grades in the class? Probably not. Would you think about who had the highest IQ? Probably not. You know, the best looking? Probably not. A whole bunch of things would go through your mind. I think you'd be amazed at how most of you would settle on a relatively few individuals. But the interesting thing is that when you think about what's going through your mind, you're not thinking about things that are impossible for you to achieve yourself. You're not thinking about who can jump 7 feet, who can throw a football 65 yards, you know, who can recite pi to 300 digits, or whatever it may be. You're thinking about a whole bunch of qualities of character. And the truth is that every one of those qualities is obtainable. They're largely a matter of habit. Now, Ben Franklin, and actually my old boss, Ben Graham, when he was 12 years old, wrote down all the qualities that he admired in other people, and he wrote down the qualities that he found objectionable. And he looked at that list, and there wasn't anything there about being able to run the 100-yard dash in 9.6 or high jumping 7 feet. They were all things that were simply a matter of deciding whether you were going to be that kind of person or not. And when you're young, you really have that opportunity. As you get older, it gets tougher because somebody has said the chains of habit are too light to be felt until they're too heavy to be broken. And in terms of behavior, you know, I see that all the time. So the time to form the right habits is very early, but it's the right habits, the habits that you would admire.